And I am a grazer. I find that I like to eat meat.
Good morning. We invite you to join with us.
And I am finding.
This is my grandkids. I had to open up a closet.
This is all my friends. My only kid.
Here together. Okay, I want to welcome everybody. Is there anybody here with us for the very first time? No, we're all returnees? Wonderful. That's wonderful. Okay. Before I go any further, they rearranged the announcements a little bit. So first off, we need to say thank you to our musicians today. And there's a whole team here, as you can see. Thank you very much for being here, our musicians today. Our guest speaker today will be Reverend Michael Bogar. And he will be speaking here shortly. But that's who we're having as our speaker today. Okay, some acknowledgments. The minister's angel is Susan Henderson. Okay. Is there anybody serving on Youth Ed today? It's Nora? That's what it says on my list. Okay, Nora is serving for the Youth Ed today. Our board member representative is Joe? Or?
Not me. I don't think it's me, but I could be me.
Okay.
It is now.
It's Kimberly.
Kimberly, thank you. Okay, and we have two prayer chaplains in service today, Jamie and Mary Ellen. They're wearing the prayer shawls. If you would like supportive prayer following the service, they'll be available at the chapel here for you, and that's a wonderful resource. Okay, serving on hospitality today, it's Mary Ellen Babbitt. And there's a spick and span angel, also Mary Ellen Babbitt. She's very busy today. Wow. But that's usually the case. If Mary Ellen Babbitt wasn't around, this place would just fall apart. That's literally true. Okay. And also, We have another angel who has stepped in to do a number of functions. He's hiding right now in the kitchen, but his name is Billy Wright. So he's been putting signs out at the curb for us, and also he has been helping with the Food for Life, or the Food for the Homeless program that we work on as Jim Bryan recovers. There he is. So he's been stepping in and helping with several functions like that. Also, a thank you to our sound technician, Mark Swink. He's back there in the booth with the headphones. Yes, and he helps us with all things technical. So that's wonderful. Okay, so we're going to have another joy song. Take it away. Everybody has a red harp either in their pocket or at a special place at home. But what this represents is the spirit of love that we each carry within us. Okay, and we carry this out on our journey of faith wherever we are, and we share it with, we share our heart. It represents sharing our heart with the world. So we share our heart. We know the world is a better place when we're willing to share our hearts. The symbol of the steadfast spirit that lives within each one of us. And we ask you to carry the symbol as a member of this Red Heart Fellowship. Let it be a reminder that the love of God is always with you, and to share your heart wherever you go. And we know that as a symbol of fellowship in the world, we can spread love one heart at a time. So let's start the movement here. Okay. Some brief announcements. I do want to mention that our guest speaker today, Reverend Michael Bogar, has some CDs available for sale. So they are in the fellowship area, and on a table there you can look at them following the service. So just so you know, they're available to you. Some other things coming up. Of course, on Wednesdays we have our Course in Miracles study group, and that's an open group. We meet at 7 p.m. on Wednesdays. On Thursday, there are two classes ongoing, the prosperity class. Oh, there's a note here that it's on hold. Okay, the quest class is continuing, and that begins on Thursday evenings at 7:30 p.m. Okay, coming up on February 26th, we're going to have a musical service. So a whole service dedicated to music with Jessa Young. She's been with us before, so we can look forward to that. And also coming up March 5th, our guest speaker will be Joanna Gabriel once again. Yay! Okay, and there's more announcements in your bulletin if you want to look at them about upcoming speakers and so on, but that's all there available for you. Okay, are there any announcements that I wasn't aware of before? Yes? Oh, you wanted to, oh, Mary Ellen's going to talk to you about a fundraiser for the church, and this is a great one.
So it may look like I do everything. However, I just am a very poor scheduler. I have to schedule everything that I'm doing here today. But we have an ongoing fundraiser, and I have a few cards left for February. These are flower cards. For $25, you get 12 bouquets, one per month, and about $8.50 of that comes back to the church. So it's not one of these where you pay a lot of money and we get, you know, a dollar or something. So this is a very good fundraiser. A lot of people like it. If you have a wife or a girlfriend, or you visit a lot of people at the nursing home or something, these are great. You could just, you go in and they give you a nice little bouquet of about three flowers. They put some nice little cellophane in a bow around it for you. And that's it, all the flowers to go places. And there are seven locations. There's a couple in Bremerton and Port Orchard, Silverdale, Paulsbo, Tacoma even. And one in, there was one in Belfair, but I don't see it on the list anymore, so you never know. So anyway, we have those. See me after church. And I would like to thank Kat Gray and Cindy Swink, because they've come in and jumped in. As you know, Ann Miller is on vacation, and she's the one who normally does hospitality. So it isn't just me. We've had several people in. Some come in early and make coffee and do stuff, and some help stay for cleanup. But we do need some more people to help with those things. So if you're inclined to help with hospitality, bring something, see me. We'll get you on the sign-up list. Thank you.
Thank you, Mary Ellen. And you were talking about if somebody has a wife or a girlfriend. I know some
boyfriend.
Well, I was just going to say that I know some gentlemen who love roses and who love orchids, and you know they love their flower gardens. So I'm opening it up. It's an equal opportunity thing, you know. Get flowers for whoever. Wonderful thing. Okay. So we're going to have our invocation and statement of faith. It's on the screen. Can we say this together, please? There is one
presence and one power active in the universe and in my life, God the good, omnipotence.
Thank you. Okay. So we're going to have a time of greeting. Now, please, we're going to keep it short because we do have fellowship time following the service. So keep it brief. We're going to say good morning to each other, handshakes and hugs. If you don't want to be hugged, shove out your hand really quick, okay? And if you hug, hug gently. Okay, let's say hello to each other.
Oh. I hug you.
You are grown.
You don't want to be hugged.
That's who you are. You are grown.
Hey! He doesn't do any good. He just took out your hand and saw it.
Oh, I wasn't trying to stop you.
No, I know.
Hey, good morning.
Hello.
Yes.
Good morning.
Hey, Jeff.
Come here, honey.
I want to hug here before I get mad.
Divine love and understanding to all. When I tune in to news of terrorism, racism, climate change, and more, I may wonder if there will ever be peace in our world. Yet I'm also familiar with the deep peace found in the presence of spirit. Peace begins with each one of us, and I have the power to access it at any time. Through divine peace, I learn to express divine love and understanding to all. I take a moment now to turn off the news and breathe into the peaceful presence within. Here I find a sense of hope for the world. Engaging the power of imagination, I envision humanity acting with respect for all life. I glimpse the realized potential of a world at peace. I know we can and will achieve peace, one breath at a time. From John 20, verse 21, Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." Today, I express divine love and understanding to all.
Yeah.
Guest speaker today is Reverend Michael Bober. Let's welcome him.
Thank you, thank you. Is that okay? Is that too loud?
No, that's fine.
Here? Good morning.
Morning.
Wait.
I did have some special music I wanted to offer right before.
Okay.
You're talking, you know.
Never mind.
This is a lovely little song. It's written by Dougie McLean, and it talks about all the hardships we face when life becomes life, but how this divine love that we are and we're connected to can carry us through all whatever it is we might face. And
Thank you. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning.
I've known Rosella for a long time. And we used to meet over at the Kingston Church, I think it was, and do Bible study together. So anyway, I understand that she's going through, they're going through a difficult time. So we support them this morning with our prayers, and I have been praying for them. My own sister was diagnosed about 2 months ago with stage 4 cancer. So I understand that difficult situation. I walked in this morning and was given a heart. How many of you, do you do this every Sunday?
Yes.
Okay. Which was very interesting because this week I've been wrestling with what to share with you. And it was very clear this morning. I woke up about 6 o'clock and the word heart just kept coming to mind. And specifically, the heart related to this date. My son, Jason, was born on February 19th today. And I can get this to stay up here if I can. I think that'll work. So he would have been 34 today. And he was born in Forest Park, Illinois, 1983. And I was in seminary at the time, and he was a third of 3 children, the youngest. And he came into this world with a flourish. For those of you that have had children, especially if you've been in the delivery room, you know that each one comes out as a unique little individual heart or soul. They show their uniqueness in the first breath and in the first movements, and he came out ready to go. And he was like that the whole time he was growing up. He was very active, incredibly energetic. He couldn't sit still in school, so we actually had to put him in a school that combined kinesthetic activity as well as intellectual learning. And he graduated, you know, early, actually, at the age of 17. But before I tell you the rest of the story about Jason and this day, February 19th, his birthday, and how it relates to heart, I want to share a little background from the poet John Keats. I know you're familiar with John Keats, the romantic poet. Lived in the 1800s. He was diagnosed with tuberculosis when he was very young, and actually died of tuberculosis at the age of 25. And his brother died of tuberculosis a year before him, and Keats nursed his brother through that death, and others in his family had died of tuberculosis. And in 1819, he wrote a letter to his brother, Keats did. And in this letter, he was musing on his own end of life. He had just published some poetry and been recognized as an amazing poet and was anticipating many years of writing poetry and knew that that wasn't going to happen, that he was probably going to leave this earth very quickly. So when he wrote this letter to his brother, he was about close to 25 and would die a year later. And he knew that. And in this letter he said to his brother, he said, "I've been musing on the purpose of this life recently. And," he said, "it seems to me that this world is not a vale of tears, as it's often designated. It's the world of soul making. The vale of soul making. The valley of soul making." And then he went on in the letter to describe what he called an idea that he yet barely perceived. But he said, "It seems to me that each of us comes into this world with lessons written on the horn book of the heart." Now, how many of you know what a horn book is? Anybody? What's a horn book?
They used them in early learning in the Plymouth colonies.
Yes, they used them in the 1700s, 1800s. They were little tablets that were covered in melted down deer or oxen horn. It actually liquefied, and it was used as a laminate. They would put the lessons on these little pieces of wood and then laminate them and then put a hole in them, and they would hang on the sash of a girl or on the belt of a boy, and they would walk to school with their lessons written on the horn book on this little piece of board. So Keats uses that metaphor, and he says, "I suspect each of us comes into this world with our own horn book. The lessons are written on the heart of each individual as we come into this world." And he, of course, was seeing one of the lessons on his own horn book as tuberculosis. So he framed his experience in the idea of this world as being the world where the heart is shaped and formed by the experiences that one goes through in this life. And he went on in this letter to his brother, and he said, I suspect that we move through this veil of soul making, that the heart may experience 1,000 different things each day, that it might form a unique individual through those lessons and through those experiences. And then he went on and said, not only is the heart a horn book or a lesson book, the heart is the mind's Bible. Now get that image. The heart is the mind's Bible. What's the purpose of the Bible? Why do people read the Bible?
Spiritual direction from?
God. So what Keats is saying here, he's not putting down the Bible, but what he's saying is each of us has a sort of innate Bible in our own heart by the experiences we have in this life, and that the mind reflecting on those experiences gets revelations from the infinite source. That the heart is the mind's Bible. Isn't that a beautiful image? That you can read about other people's experiences in the Bible, but all of those experiences are people whose hearts were affected in this life, and then they wrote the lessons down. And they're good for us, but more direct is your own heart's experiences of this life. And Keats went on and he said, not only is the heart a lesson book and a Bible, he said, it is the nipple from which we suckle our identity. Isn't that a beautiful image? He says the experiences that each of us has in this life become imprinted on the heart. They not only become imprinted on the heart, they become a kind of mother with a breast that when we have moments of reflection and we ponder. How many of you have pondered the past at all? So Keats is framing this in the sense of what depth psychology calls the innate reflective response of the heart. That the heart, we innately reflect because that's what we're made to do. And that if we can frame these reflections in a kind of way of seeing that these reflections are nursing us, they are nurturing us, they are growing a soul or making a soul through the experiences that we've all gone through. So Keats, as he was knew he was dying of tuberculosis, was essentially saying that I am choosing to frame what I'm going through right now as an experience of making my own unique soul. Now, I had this image in mind, and this frame of reference in mind, when in 2008, there was a knock on my door. January 13th, 2008. There was a knock on my door. And a chaplain and an accompanying soldier from Fort Lewis came into my house, and they informed me that my son had been killed that day in Wanat, Afghanistan, the Korangal Valley. It was a big story. It was in the news for actually 2 or 3 years. The state of Washington flew the flags at half mast. 9 men were killed there. 2 or 3 dozen were wounded. It was the worst battle they had had in Afghanistan up until that point, 2008. I have never gone through such devastation. The only thing I remember when they gave me this news was that I said, no, no, no. And then I went into a kind of blackout. And I kind of came to about 2 minutes later, standing outside, shaking my fist at the sky, saying, no, this can't be. Now, some of you in this room have lost children, I suspect. It's a club that no one wants to belong to. But once you do, there is a sort of co-fraternity or a kind of community that forms there. Now, what's interesting is just before Jason went on this third deployment to Afghanistan, he'd been to Iraq in 2004, he'd been to Iraq and Afghanistan about 2005, and in 2007 he went back to Afghanistan, and that's when he was killed in Afghanistan. But on the other two deployments, when Jason came home, he was a lost young man. Some of you know what I mean by this. When he's in the military, he did very well because they had these restraints and this orderly, organized kind of life. But when he would get home and sort of move out of the military framework, he would spend a whole lot of time partying. And after his second deployment, got home around 2006 or so, 2007, he was partying and he got in a fight and he had his jaw busted and he had his eye socket smashed up and he went through a really, really rough time and he came and sort of recouped living with me. And I'd been worried about him, as any parent. Some of you know what I mean. You have children, you have grandchildren, you know what I'm talking about. I was very concerned about him, and he'd been going through a number of things like this on and off through the years. But one day, about 6 months before he deployed for his last deployment, he came to my study, and he sat down in the chair, and he threw his leg up over the arm of the chair. He put his hand on his leg, I'll never forget it. And he looked at me, and this is after he'd been through a whole lot of stuff, soul-making. And he looked at me, and he put his hand on his heart, and he started patting his chest. And he says, I know what you mean, Dad. I thought he was screwing with me, because he was a trickster. I mean, in the most lovely, delicious way. But he patted his chest, and he said, I know what you're talking about, Dad. And I said, well, what? He says, it's here. I said, what? What's here? He goes, it's here. It's in the heart. I said, what? He said, this God thing you keep talking about. And I still was a little cautious because I was waiting for the punchline. But there was no punchline. He had had an experience, an awakening of the heart that completely reoriented his life. And everybody in the family and all the people that knew him for the last few months before he deployed in that last deployment said, what happened to Jason? I said, he had that heart conversion. He had that heart awakening. He had that experience of the heart where the soul, and this is what Keats was talking about, the soul often goes through many troubling and difficult things in order that it may be broken and reconstructed. And everybody in this room knows what I'm talking about, because everybody in this room looks old enough to me to have had their heart broken at least once. And what Keats is saying is that the purpose of this world, as he saw it, is the veil of soul making, meaning that we come into this world not just the physical heart, but the heart as an image of that inner character, that inner self, that unique individual we're becoming. He says we come into this world to have that heart shattered in order that it might be reconstructed. And then shattered again and reconstructed. The Jewish rabbis have a beautiful image for this. The Jewish rabbis say that God has dropped us into this world tied to the end of a string. And we're down here dangling in this world going, where's God? And so we wander around, say the Jews, the rabbi. We wander around and we keep breaking the string. And what does God do? He reties it. And he said, the rabbi said, every time we break the string, God reties it. And we get closer to God. That's the heart. So it frames these experiences in this world we call tragedy. And they are tragedies. This doesn't minimize the pain of these experiences, but it gives them purpose. The purpose of this world, says Keats, is to make a soul through these various breakings and reconnectings. After Jason's death, that night after I went heard the news, and some family came over and stayed for a while, and at the end of the evening, people went home, and I went up to my bedroom, and I sat down on the edge of my bed in this state of, I can't describe it. And I sat down on the edge of my bed. I knew I wasn't going to sleep, but I sat there, but I knew this idea of soul making, and I knew this perspective. And I knew that these journeys into the underworld are part of this life. And I remember saying to myself, or to someone, what's happening now? And I heard a voice. It wasn't audible, but it was very clear. It said, you are now going into the underworld. And your heart is going to be broken. And my next question was, anybody want to know when you hear a voice that says you are now going into the underworld? How long? I said, how long? And you know what I heard? Silence. And silence is an answer. Because silence suggests you will stay there until you're done. Now, I have gone through these experiences prior to that. I went through divorce back in 1990 and went into the underworld, but I didn't understand this soul-making perspective. So rather than go into the underworld and have my heart re-knit, reconnected, rebuilt, I drank tequila on and off for 10 years. Do I hear an amen? It didn't work very well, because what happens when you postpone the heart surgery is it just prolongs it. So this time I knew, I understood I was going into the underworld, I understood that I was going into the realm of gods and angels, and that there were going to be experiences that would come to me in order to rebuild my heart and to rebuild my son's heart. About 3 days after this, I was on my knees beside my bed, weeping and praying. If you've ever wept and prayed at the same time, you know what I'm talking about. Choking out tears to the point that you don't think you'll catch your breath again. And as I was praying, I saw, my eyes were closed, I saw in a sort of a vision something moving above me. It looked like a flag waving. And the flag would turn around, and then it would come back to the other side. It was like a rug or a flag, or it was annoying me. And I remember praying, and this thought in my head was, go away, I'm trying to pray. And then something said, look up, stupid, in my vision. And in my mind's eye, I looked up, and it was a tapestry. And it would go from the side with all the knots showing and the strings, if you've ever seen a tapestry, you know, and then it would move slowly around and I would see this beautiful image. I can't even remember what it is now, or was, but it was a beautiful image. And then it would rotate back to the knotted side. And then it would turn again to the perfected side. And then I heard my son's voice. It was very, very clear. He said, Dad, there's two sides to the tapestry. You can't see what's on the other side. All you can see right now are the knots and the threads. That's what's breaking your heart. Because here, you get limited vision in this soul-making world. But he said, there's another side. And I remember stopping the tears and feeling a sense of, there's a bigger picture here. There's a whole lot more going on in the invisible realm than there is in the visible realm. That we are tethered to a realm of angels and demons and whatever you want to call them, but spiritual beings that populate every mythology and every religion, and Star Wars and Harry Potter and Lord of the Rings. You can't create a story without all of these different characters. And most of us are in this sea of those characters, and our hearts are being touched by them, but we can only see very, very little. About a week or two after his death, I was still in the underworld. And I was going to lead a meditation over on Bainbridge Island, a group over there that I work with. And I called up Catherine LaFawn. Some of you may know Catherine, I don't know if you do, but I called her up and I said, I don't want to meditate tonight. You ever, you know, get to that place to where you just don't want to be spiritual? Like, screw it. I said, I'll come to the meditation, but would you please lead the meditation? And she said, sure. So I went over there. Again, this is 2 weeks into this experience of losing my son. And I remember sitting down thinking, I'll let them meditate. I'm just going to close my eyes and just relax. And Catherine started the meditation. I don't even remember what she said, but it was a beautifully guided meditation. And I unintentionally went into this deep meditative state. And as I was in this state, you know what I'm talking about, kind of between sleep and waking. You know you're not asleep, but you're in another place. I wasn't expecting anything. There was just this sort of void, this what the ancients called chaos. Chaos was not disorder. Chaos is an empty space. And I was in this empty space. And all of a sudden, Jason shows up in this dark void. And the picture is almost identical to this. He had his helmet on, his big brown eyes, a little smile he always wore on his face, and he shows up as clear or more clear than you are in this room right now. It was the most crystal clear vision I've ever had, but I saw him from just about his chest up. And in my meditation state, I didn't speak, but in my mind I spoke, my heart I spoke, and I said, what are you doing here? And he smiled, and then his hands came up out of the dark, and he put his hands on his chest, and I swear to God, he reached in his chest, and he pulled out this big red heart. It was the reddest heart I've ever seen, and it was throbbing, it was huge, it was beautiful, like those pictures of the Sacred Heart of Jesus, if you've ever seen those. And he held it up in front of me, and in the meditation, I was looking at him, I was saying, what are you doing? And he started to push it toward me, and I said, what are you doing? You can't do this. And at the same time, out of my chest floated this little shriveled up black and blue heart. And it hovered. The two hearts were hovering there in front of me. And he smiled and he kept pushing his heart into this little shriveled up heart that came out of my chest. And his heart engulfed it like water on a sponge, and it just completely engulfed this darkened, shriveled up heart, and he pushed it right into my chest, his heart. And he said to me, Dad, part of the reason I died was to give you a bigger heart. He said, your heart's not big enough to do the work you do. And it was so startling that I opened my eyes in shock at the vividness of the meditation, the vividness of the vision, and there was no question in my mind what had happened. So I'm here this morning in part not only to celebrate my son's 34th birthday, but to share that his death was more than just a wasted life.
Yeah.
I had people come to me, and my father actually, and this was not a malicious thing that he said, he was in deep grief, and he said, what a waste.
Oh.
And there's a sense, I get it. My son was 25, same age as Keats. And I get my father's idea of what a waste, because I too wanted to see him grow up and grow up as his father, and he had an amazing future ahead of him. But it was not a waste. And I want to, as we close this morning, I want to encourage each of us as we do this kind of closing meditation. Let's just do it. If you'd like to join me, close your eyes. Take a breath. Take a breath. Take a breath. And part of the purpose of meditation and prayer, meditation, medium. We move into that medium, that interim place between the visible and the invisible. That place where the heart has one foot in this world that feels and experiences, and another foot in the world of the invisible that does magic in a way that we can't even imagine. So I encourage each of us this morning to just take a moment and to affirm that no matter what's going on right now, to trust that there is more going on than meets the eye, that there are two sides to this tapestry called your life, that your heart has been going through many, many experiences in this life, falling apart and coming back together. And each experience has made you a more unique, holy, sacred individual. The work goes on. Part of what I saw in this experience with my son is that his soul making continues as well. It's not just mine. Our ancestors, loved ones, all of those invisibles are working on this stage, this in this great drama, this play called your life, our world's life. This morning, as we go from this place, help us to see that no matter what troubles us in the world, there's a bigger purpose in every experience. When Jesus said, let not your heart be troubled, you believe in me, you believe in the Father also. But what he's saying is our hearts are never out of the hands of the infinite soul maker. And so it is. Blessings on you this morning.
That's not the title.
I had to eat.
and the tribes of men. I would give my heart's desire so that you might see. The first step is to realize it all begins with you and me.
Represents that spark of divinity within each one of us, that spark of divinity that we share with the world when we share our heart. So we're going to have a time of offertory here, and as you're preparing your gifts today, think about how blessed you are, and as you're writing your check or giving your gift, send your blessings out to the world. And say a blessing for this church as well, that it can continue and share its blessings with our community. Okay, thank you.
I am so grateful for all that I have. I am.
Okay, could I have a board member, Kimberly, and Jamie, one of our chaplains, come forward, and one of our ushers is bringing for us the offering. Is Kimberly still with us?
She's double duty. Kimberly's...
Oh, okay. All right. We're gonna bless the offering together along with these people. The congregation joins in, and the blessing is on the screen. So let's bless our offering. Together, we dedicate these gifts in service to the highest mission, recognizing and celebrating our oneness with God. We joyfully and freely participate in the law of circulation of giving and receiving, knowing God is source, the source of all good, and we are grateful. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. We do have a food program for the homeless. It's basically to provide them with lunches. Normally, Jim Bryan and Charlene are responsible for doing that, but they're busy with a healing challenge. And so Billy Wright has stepped forward to help with this. And normally somebody will take the bag home and fill it with items that can be used in lunches to go, and brings it back the next day. The next Sunday. Is anybody willing to take the bag for this week? Thank you, Larry. I'll have the bag up here for you, okay, after the service. Okay, so that's available for you.
Deb, I also posted there's on the board, and I kind of crossed it to the box up there, the food box. There's other things, backpacks and stuff like that, that anybody
requests.
Has that they can
request for.
Okay, so they're asking for backpacks to be
contributed. Yeah,
there's
a list of items on you
a
know,
list of items.
Yeah,
on
I asked them if they would take furniture, and they said that's kind of rough for a homeless person.
yeah, items that are easily
food on the wheels. And I also wanted to say that I took Candace for her knee surgery Friday.
Do you want to come up and talk in the microphone?
Please do.
Come on. Hi. I took Candace for her knee surgery on Friday. It went well. I talked to the doctor. He said that it had gone very well. She's kind of in a lot of pain right now, but she's a trooper. She's doing pretty good each day. And I know from my hip surgery, every 24 hours is miraculous. Mm-hmm. You know, the body, what it can do. And so she, I texted her this morning. She seemed real positive, and she is leaning heavily on her, the Holy Spirit, and her higher power for strength to get through it. And so, if you could just say a little prayer for her, that'd be great.
Yeah.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you, Billy. Okay, and so this is the time when people can share good news. Anybody have any good news that they'd like to share? Thank you, Joyce.
I do. It says, a warm winter wish at the new year. This card is from our dear friend Mary. And Mary, for those of you who don't know, which probably are very few, she's lives with her daughter in California now. So if everyone would turn to the camera and say, hi, Mary. Oh, that would be awesome.
Hi, Mary.
Hi, Mary.
So this says, thank you so much. So many of us signed a card and we sent it to her. So she's responding. Thank you so much for the great letter. It is nice to be remembered. Things are pretty good down here. I have my sewing machine set up. She's more than an octogenarian too, by the way.
Yes.
I have a new sewing table. I go to Sit and Be Fit class twice a month. There is about 25 people that attend. I also walk. I miss all of you, and I do see the service on my computer. So she's watching. I do get to the Unity Church here once a month as I don't drive. Thanks again. May the year bring you answered prayers, and may you be surrounded with great happiness. Love, hugs, and blessings, Mary.
Thank you so much. Anybody else have any good news to share? Okay, this is our time for our children. So could we have the children come forward and let's welcome them.
Well, we worked on making posters because we've been talking about the prayer protection. And so we made posters about what that looks like. So show me your poster.
Ooh, that's cool.
Obviously, the love of God surrounds Jenny.
Oh, that's cool.
Anyone?
No.
The heart of
and he's got an angel watching him. Watching over him, that's God watching over him. Then, what God looking over, you know, everything.
Is that yours?
Yes. This one. Because looking over me and then God watching over me. And then God's power.
Oh, I should be
the arm. Those of us who know Nora know that she is young at heart, and so it's very appropriate. So at this time we'd like to bless Nora and our young man here, and the blessing is on the screen. Let's say this together.
We love you, we bless you, and we appreciate you just the way you are.
Thank you so much. Wonderful. So, we're ready to have our peace song and on our closing prayer of protection. So, if you'd like to stand and grab a hand.
Is well.
Thank you.